All set?
Okay. Yes, I've left a message for Representative Gabbard indicating to her that I felt that as a result of her presidential campaign and the necessities that she's encountered in that presidential campaign, that I felt it was incumbent upon her to resign her office presently in the United States Congress. As a former member of Congress, a former member of the Hawaii congressional team, I've been through this same challenge myself. Can you do a job for the people of Hawaii and conduct a separate campaign or an additional campaign? And obviously some people can do it, and some particular representations can handle it. There are senators now running for president, for example, who are continuing to their service, and their constituents will make up their minds as to whether or not that's a plausible thing to do, possible for them to continue. The same here in Hawaii itself, of course, people can run for another office. So that's not the issue. The issue is whether you're able to do it, and it is quite clear to me that Representative Gabbard is unable to do that, despite, I'm sure, her best intentions. She's missed virtually all of the votes so far, up to and including after last week, coming and voting present at the impeachment vote, missing the vote on the financing of the United States government that took place right after. The entire appropriations, eight appropriations bills, and domestic spending for the next year for the United States of America, including Hawaii, and she wasn't there for that vote. So it's clear to me that we need to have representation in this instance for the second district. It's even more important, I think, when you're representing the windward side of Oahu and the neighbor islands. It takes an effort. You have to be able to be physically present and able to do it. And so whatever her future holds in terms of a presidential campaign, I think in order for the people of Hawaii to be properly represented, she should resign the seat and allow a special election to take place. And the sooner the better, because we're on a little bit of a break now, and with the new year there'll be a pause in the congressional activity that would give an opportunity for a special election to be called. Not everyone may be familiar. You cannot appoint someone to the House of Representatives. You can appoint to the United States Senate. I've been through that myself. But you cannot appoint to the House of Representatives. There must be an election to the People's House. And with the new opportunity with mail-in ballots, I think a special election could be held conveniently, reasonably in terms of cost, and most importantly, that the people of the Second District of Hawaii will be properly represented and that our delegation be full. We only have four members in that delegation, and just having three there for all intents and purposes does not handle it. So I wish her the best of good fortune in whatever she's pursuing and however it goes, but I feel very, very strongly that the Second District of Hawaii needs to be fully represented. Our delegation needs to be fully represented, and I hope that she will understand both my motivation and the practicality for her constituents in the Second District to have a resignation and a special election.
Senators Cory Booker and Kamala Harris, before she dropped out, missed a similar amount of votes, almost all of the votes, you know, in recent months.
Yes.
Because of the presidential bid. Why do you feel it's different for Tulsi Gabbard?
Well, I can't account for them. As I said, you have to take that up with your constituents, and they'll have to take it up with their constituents. And they'll make a decision then about whether or not they can continue in office. I don't know whether they have an election in the fall or not. But Representative Gabbard's in a bit of a different situation than Senator Booker or Senator Harris, because she's indicated she's not running again. I think this is something that needs to be emphasized. She, because of her presidential campaigning, she's unable to attend the necessary meetings and votes in the Congress. And she's indicated two things. One, she's not going to run for re-election. So she's not running for re-election. The incentive, if you will, to represent literally the second district, it kind of disappears. It's quite clear that she won't be able to do it. Because she's also moved from the state. She's indicated, my information is that she's indicated she's actually moved to New Hampshire for the primary that's upcoming. Now, I don't know if she's actually given up residency in Hawaii or not, and she may be renting a facilities or a residence in New Hampshire, but the operative phrase is, I've moved to New Hampshire. So if she's moved to New Hampshire, she's not running for re-election, she can't or doesn't come to votes, the second district is not being represented, and I feel that a special election is in order so that Hawaii gets the kind of representation it deserves.
What prompted you to make this announcement today? Is this something you've been thinking about for a while?
Well, I'm not going to say the last straw. I've been thinking, that's a good question. I have been thinking about it because I've done it. I had to think about it in 2010 when I ran for governor, and I had to make a decision whether I could both represent the first district and run for governor at the same time, and I concluded I could not do that, and as a result I offered my resignation, and then the people had to decide in that, both in the primary and the general election, whether they thought that was something that in the end benefited the state in terms of the election, and of course I was successful in that. So whether you're successful or not is not the issue. It's whether or not you could do the job. So I was thinking about that, but when she just showed up for and then voted present, I thought, wait a minute, you know, that's a step too far. So that brought me to the conclusion of what I've been thinking all along, that if she could maintain her voting record, if she could maintain her activities in the Congress and be out here in Hawaii to represent the people in person. I mean, I did that for 20 years. I know what it takes. If you represent Hawaii in the United States Congress, in the center of the House, it means you have a 5,000-mile one-way commute. And for 20 years, it was not unusual for me to leave on a Friday and go back on a Sunday night or a Monday. I don't say that with any particular, you know, three cheers for me. That was part of the job. Just like you're here today, you're going to go where the news is, and if that's convenient for you, fine. If it isn't, then that's part of the job. So part of the job of being a representative in the Congress, whether it's in the Senate or in the House, is you've got to make that commute and still do your work. So it became clear to me that she was missing votes, lots and lots of votes. And then when she did show up, she didn't vote. She votes present. Again, I think for presidential reasons. That's up to her. She said what she did and why she did it and so on. But it has to do with her presidential campaign. It has nothing to do with representing the people of Hawaii. So I thought, okay, that's it. I need to say something. As I say, having been through it myself, and understanding the importance of having a full delegation in Washington, I felt it was important for me to express that to her as I have. And to the people of Hawaii.
Governor, along with having the people of CD2 have representation, can you talk about some of the other benefits of getting someone in that seat right away?
Again, I don't know if everybody heard the question, but the question was, are there any benefits, if you will, to getting somebody into that seat full time? And the answer is yes. The hard reality is if we have a special election, and whoever wins that election is also able to establish a good enough record so that he or she can win the primary upcoming and general election, that means that person will have seniority over everyone else who's elected in November of next year. I've been through that myself. I want to speak. You know, I've been through all of these things myself, so I have some authority to speak on it. I won a special election in 1986 when then Representative Heftel resigned to run for governor. And as a result of winning that special election, when I won re-election in 4 years later, I had been able to re-secure the seat on the Armed Services Committee that I was assigned when I went in the special election. Even though it was for a short period of time, I was a fully participating member. I happened to be the last person sworn in by then Speaker Tip O'Neill before he retired, and I got an assignment on the Armed Services Committee and the Resources Committee that has everything to do with oceans and the environment and national parks and land issues. And so when I returned 4 years later to Congress, I had the seniority over everybody elected then. I think this election, there's going to be a lot of changes in the Congress, particularly in the House, I think. So Tulsi can obviously carry on her presidential campaign, but she can do something for Hawaii in as much as she's not running again, give an opportunity for someone to serve and gain a seniority boost. With our little delegation, you know, two people out of 435, two people out of 100 in the Senate, we need that representation, we need that seniority.
Governor, you're obviously supporting Kaika Hale for his congressional bid.
Yeah, I should have said right from the very beginning, and I apologize to you. I'm speaking here for myself as a former congressman and someone who's been through this situation. I am a co-chair of Senator Kahele's campaign, and you'll note that that Governor Cayetano and Governor Waihei are not here with me today. I determined I determined that I thought it was appropriate for me as a former member of Congress to do it, not as a co-chair of the Kahele campaign. I didn't ask Senator Kahele if it was okay for me to do this. I told him what I was going to do. Whether it benefits him or doesn't benefit him is immaterial. People will make that decision. But I assure you, I'm here in the capacity that I've just said, and I think people know me well enough. If I was speaking for or as a result of participation in the Kahele campaign, I'd say so.
So if there was a special election, you would still be endorsing?
Oh yes, I mean, if Representative Gabbard carries through on, I'm sure it's not just my suggestion. If she carries through on that and there is a special election, of course I'll be supporting Senator Kahele. But that's a winner-take-all election. I've been through this. You know, and endorsements are not necessary. You know, I often say to people when people talk about endorsements, I say, well, is it going to help you or is it going to hurt you? You know, it all depends. So endorsements can work both ways. Well, I didn't hear that. So, I'm sure Governor Ige is. I think you'll all agree I've made it a practice since the night of the primary in 2014, when I was defeated in the primary and went on the stage with Governor Ige. I've tried to indicate that, out of respect for the office, that I would refrain from commenting on observations or issues unless I thought there was something that affected me. In his last campaign, I had a word or two to say about some of the advertising. But other than that, Governor Ige is perfectly capable of commenting himself on whatever issue he thinks is important.
Do you think Gabbard will take your advice?
Some of you are old enough, I guess, to know that I've been around long enough to know that I was an early supporter of Representative Gabbard. As a matter of fact, I think I was one of the first people to endorse her when she first began her run for the congressional office, and I can say as well that some of the issues that she's concentrated on in terms of keeping us out of wars where we're using the military for political policies is something that I have supported. So I have been a supporter of Representative Gabbard, and I certainly do not argue with her intention to run for president. If she had asked me about it, I would have counseled her not to do it. For reasons having to do with Hawaii, our representation. I worked hard to help get her some of her committee assignments, which I think have benefited Hawaii, and hopefully I can still have some influence in that direction if she does resign. I hope she will. It's not a question of whether she's going to pay attention to me. It's a question of whether she'll pay attention to her duty as a representative to the people of Hawaii. And and I think if she considers it in that context, then I'm not confident she would resign, but I would hope that she'd come to that same conclusion.
How did she react to your phone call?
I beg your pardon?
You said you called her.
Unfortunately, I've since she's been running for president, we've dealt mostly through messages. she's pretty busy, and of course the time change and all that. I haven't spoken to her personally on this, but I have left a message where I know she's heard it.
Okay.
I beg your pardon?
Not responded at all.
Not yet. I've just concluded I was going to do this within the last couple of days. I beg your pardon?
Is there anyone else in the position of power here in Hawaii that's calling for the same action?
Am I to assume that I'm in a position of power? Is that what?
Yes,
no, I'm sorry. I'm just giving you a bad time on that. No, I'm not aware, but I haven't solicited anybody either. I just felt, as I indicated, I hope clearly at the beginning, that as a former member of Congress and as a member of the delegation and someone who's been through the question of should you continue in the office you occupy or resign, and having been through special elections, I thought I want to share my conclusions then with the general public, because I believe the people in the second district deserve representation and are not getting it now and are unlikely to be able to have it over the next year. Don't forget, we're talking about a year. A whole lot of things are going to be going on and happening here and in Washington over the next year. And to essentially deprive half the state of Hawaii of representation in that sense is unacceptable. I hope that she'll take it in that my suggestion in that context, and that she will resign her seat and continue with her campaign and good fortune to her in the new year.
Are there any particular legislative items that you think she's been neglecting, or that you think?
Everything. She's missing votes on almost everything. I think the best example for this is it just happened, and it's another reason I'm here today. She missed the vote. If she was there for the vote on the impeachment and then votes present, doesn't exercise the franchise of the vote, and then within 24 hours or so the budget of the United States comes up for a vote, 8 appropriations bill, all of this domestic spending for the next year, every project for Hawaii, every project, all the operating expenses, all the departments that are receiving federal funding, and she's not there. She doesn't vote. No, she was already in Washington. The only thing I can conclude is that she voted present and then left, even though the vote on the entire budget, the entire funding of the federal budget for the next year was up the next day. Now that's not acceptable. It's a, if you're representing the state, it's not acceptable in any district.
No. Your thoughts on the job she's done so far, and are there any regrets?
Yeah, well, I just want to make clear on that. I'm glad you think that I was. I think she thought I was helpful in her original campaign, but I wasn't against anybody. I was for her in that, and that's how I can try to conduct my view. Or my activities. Just as it is now, I'm not against Tulsi. I'm not against her running for president. If she feels and has concluded that she has the best, can make the best offer of leadership for the country, she should run if that's what she thinks, and she is. But that you have to then take all the full responsibilities that go along with that, and so. I think, especially when she was first in Congress, she was very, very active in Veterans Affairs and so on. I think she carried through on the things that she spoke of and talked about. But once you enter this next level, if you will, of political competition, then you have to take into account who else is affected adversely or not by it. And in this instance, I've concluded that the people of the second district are being adversely affected by her presidential campaign. And so if she offers the opportunity then for a special election, I think then she's showing respect for the people of the second district and respect for the people of Hawaii.
Were you a co-chair for Kai before she said she wasn't going to?
I beg your pardon?
Were you a co-chair for Kai's campaign before she said she wasn't?
Yes. Yes.
Governor, what do you think of...
Well before that, yeah.
What do you think of her presidential campaign?
Did everybody hear the question, by the way? Was I for Senator Kahale for Congress, run for Congress, before she announced she wouldn't run? And the answer was yes, I was. I fully anticipated that at that point that there would be a contest between Senator Kahale and whoever else was running in the primary and Representative Gabbard.
Why did you feel this time for someone?
Well, this is when the missing of the votes started to add up, really add up. And the committee meetings and all the rest of it. And constituent service. I mean, you can't do it. It's a tricky business. To be able to do that with the commute, the 5,000 miles between here and Washington. So I'm not saying it can't be done. I'm not saying that a good faith effort either hasn't been made or could have been made and wasn't made. But the plain fact is that she's now said she won't run for re-election. She says she's moved to New Hampshire. She's missed a terrifically high percentage of votes. You can argue, I suppose, over what the exact count is, but it's extraordinarily high, maybe as high as the high 80s or low 90s, something like that. And then this impeachment situation, my polite way of putting it, I think, pointed up to me that she has particular ways that she wants to address the presidential campaign. And as a result, she cannot continue to do the kind of representation I think the people of the second district deserve. And that's another problem that needs to be addressed. And no, I'm not running for an office myself at the present moment.
So, you can say that. Are you supporting her for president?
No. Again, that's her choice to make. She didn't ask me about it. We talked more in the earlier part of her tenure in the House of Representatives, but I've never had a conversation with her about the presidential bid that she's making. I would have advised against it for reasons having to do with her situation in Congress today, which I think Well, maybe at another conference or something I could go into that as to what I think. I think she would have been much more effective retaining her seat in the House of Representatives and the committee assignments that she has in making the points about war and peace. I think she was in a good position to be able to make those points in committee and on bills, much more able to carry through on the issues of war and peace than she can in the presidential campaign. Okay? Thank you for your kind attention and your courtesy. Again, I am sorry that I wasn't here on time. Thank you.